Hey, I'm Tim. This is my non-objective opinion on People's Radio United. Today we have my guest Se7en, and we're talking about internet security, the basics of OpSec and internet security. Let's listen to Stepping Razor by Peter Tosh, and we'll be right back with Se7en.
One fifth of the tribulation. I got you. I'm like, I know. Only a name would be here to represent you. Drink lead soup. I'm dangerous. You coulda eat a fart. I'm dangerous. You coulda eat bread for crackers. I'm dangerous. But I not look no war. I'm dangerous. Father, but it's dangerous.
Hey, we're back with my non-objective opinion on People's Radio United. I'm Tim. I'm here with my guest Se7en. We'll be talking about internet security and the basics of OpSec, kind of stuff for beginners. My guest today is Se7en of Anonymous. He's highly involved in OpStop Suicide, which I try to be affiliated with when I can, and OpSerena Shim. So hello, Se7en. Why don't you tell us a little bit about you and what you do on other ops, and then we'll get started on internet security.
Well, thank you again for having me. Operation Stop Suicide, I've been involved in since its inception. A lot of us just trying to look out for each other. Quite honestly, I don't really want to go into some of the details on it because some of the
It could be a whole show just about that. But yeah, it's a really important op. People should get involved in that. If you don't know about it, what should they check out? Hashtag OpStopSuicide.
That is correct.
Okay. And you're also involved in OpSerena Shim with me.
Among many others, yes. Basically trying to get the real story as to what exactly happened to her while she was in Turkey. And exactly who was really behind her death. A lot of things have been leading towards, well, I can't really talk about that.
Yeah.
But I recommend people to follow the hashtag OpSerenaShim, and they will be able to find a lot of information that we really can't talk about, at least not on the air right now.
Yeah, that's a whole nother show as well. And we'll probably eventually do a My Non-Objective Opinion with both of those topics. We've already done one on video. People could go back and look at it. I did one on OpStop Suicide, and I did one with you. I did two with you about Serena Shim. And yeah, just go to MNOO.co or peoplesradiounited.com, and you'll find links to My Non-Objective Opinion. You can see those older shows on video as well. So yeah, you ready to get started on internet security?
Yes, I am.
Okay, so let's start off with, like, say somebody has a newer computer and they want to make it secure. What are some things they could do?
Well, there are three main type of systems that are out there now, especially if you're going for, like, a classic OS, classic operating system. Let's say you pick up a new computer with Windows 10. Excuse me, I almost gagged there. Let's say it's a brand new desktop. Brand new desktop, okay, you're going to follow the same thing as with a laptop and a tablet minus blocking the camera. With a laptop and one of the tablet-based systems, you're going to want to block the camera off. Sometimes you could use a Band-Aid, take a pair of scissors, and cut on both ends, get rid of the adhesive that's there, because that type of adhesive is pain in the ass to get off the computer when you want to remove it.
Yeah.
Take the actual gauze portion of it and some electrical tape. Cut the electrical tape to the right size to go completely over your camera's frame. Put the padding right over the camera itself, over the lens, and smooth out the tape so that way you have a nice seal. So your camera is essentially nullified. Now that comes in handy, especially if you're going to be using things like Skype or Twitter, you might accidentally hit the camera option. You don't want it randomly taking a picture of your face, especially when you're working on a project that, let's say, a government agency is not really in favor of.
Yeah, and the Band-Aid kind of method keeps your camera from having sticky tape on it.
Is that right? And also keeps the residue from getting on top of it, from getting on top of the lens. So if you actually do want to use the camera eventually, you don't have to worry about, crap, now I have to figure out a way to clean all this adhesive off.
Got it.
You just have to worry about it on the sides and, oh, big whoop, to cut another piece of tape to go over that.
Okay.
It's the same on tablets. You can block off the cameras on the tablets or on a phone if you wish.
Same.
Using the same type of method. You just use one of the really small Band-Aids.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so our cameras are secure. What else did we do?
Okay, VPNs. You're going to want to look into different types of VPNs. There are several that work on both mobile devices and also on your computers. For instance, one of the more popular ones right now is private internet access. TorGuard, that's a good one. iVanish. These are ones that you may have to pay for.
This is for beginners, so
yes.
A VPN is a virtual private network, and what exactly does it do, just really quick and briefly for those who may not know?
A VPN makes it a little bit harder for somebody to backtrace. So, for instance, right now my exit node is in Norway. I'm definitely not in Norway, but according to my computer, I am.
So it makes it harder to track where you really are.
Exactly. If somebody tries to backtrace you, it goes to the server for the VPN, and that thing is firewalled better, pretty much better than most other systems that you'll ever find.
Okay.
So it will prevent, it'll ease the ability of surfing on the net unobstructed, as well as posting your own information. Or posting whatever opinions you have online.
Yeah, I didn't want to interrupt you either. I just wanted to make sure everyone knew what we were talking about. So what you were saying, you were in the middle of saying, I think it was private internet access and TorGuard were some common VPNs people like to use.
Yeah, iVanish VPN, that's another one, Ghost VPN. These ones are all good. They have, a lot of them have free versions, some of them are paid. Services like private internet access and TorGuard, they have a monthly fee, but the thing is, though, is you can pay for them with a gift card. So that's a good thing because you can buy the gift card using cash and pay for an entire year up front using the gift card. That way the actual purchase of the VPN also can't be backtraced directly to you.
Smart.
This is especially good for press agents. That way they can get around different types of obstructions. Let's say, for instance, they're trying to tweet from Turkey. That's a big one. Turkey blocks practically everything. They've been blocking Facebook. They've been blocking Twitter. They recently blocked Snapchat.
Yeah.
So having a VPN gets you around those types of blocks. Another thing that you could use along with the VPN is something called Tor. Tor is basically a multi-level VPN, yet it's not a VPN. You can actually set up you can add the node onto your mobile device or onto your computer, whether you're using Linux operating systems, Mac operating systems, or Windows. You can tell my thrill about Windows.
So get a good VPN, block off your camera, use Tor.
I actually recommend using multiple VPNs if possible, if you're able to do that possibly. Mm-hmm. To begin with, I'd say one VPN and a Tor. That way you have your VPN. When you hit your exit node, that's where you would be able to have the Tor access from, in which case it makes it that much harder for somebody to get back directly to your VPN node.
Okay. What about encryption?
Well, there are different types of encryptions. I'd recommend trying to do research on setting up and for those of you that are new, you're going to look at this, you're going to hear this and just tilt your head to the side. Don't worry about it. You can look it up online. You'll be able to understand it. A 256-bit key AES encryption. A 256-bit encryption can be set up on mobile device. Sometimes you can just select the option to encrypt and set up a password on it. And on your computer, you can set one up directly through the BIOS. So that way your entire computer is fully encrypted when it's shut down. If somebody turns it on and they don't enter in the decrypt password, all that they can see is random data. Also, if someone should somehow get into your computer or your mobile device, all they're going to be receiving is random data. They're not going to get the unencrypted file unless you send it.
So encryption is a key thing you need to do. And then I'd recommend using encrypted email as well, correct?
Yes. Something like Proton Mail, that's a really good one, especially since they went free. It's actually a really good one. It uses a military-grade 256 AES encryption. So it's a double password setup. You have your login, your password, and then a decrypt password. So once you have your main access, it then requests you to decrypt your network through yourself. And that can be accessed on, again, mobile devices. There's now an app for that. Given that I just said that, there's an app for it. They have an application for it. You can access it through your browser. So accessing it on a tablet is no problem. Same thing with any type of mobile system.
Yeah, Proton Mail is awesome. We've been talking about passwords. Let's get into that a little bit, if it's okay with you. Talk about how to store your passwords, maybe what are good passwords and what are bad passwords.
Storing your passwords, the last thing you want to do is store them on your computer. Some type of thing, like a sticky note, a note card, something you can easily hide, and something that you know the location. I mean, storing it on your computer, okay, fine. If somebody should somehow breach your computer, and we'll probably get to that later, if somebody breaches your computer, they can access all of your passwords, all of your accounts. So keeping that offline, off a data system, that's probably one of the best ideas. It's one of the most secure fashions.
Okay. How do you create passwords? What's the best way to create passwords?
Usually random numbers and letters as well as symbols helps. Try to keep it at around 15 characters and something that you can remember. Or you could go for something completely insane and off the wall. You could go for a phrase from a movie, for instance. And instead of just using that phrase in plain text English, turn it into the old gamer's code called LEAP 1337. There are translators for it online if you wish, or you can learn it very easily. You could take something like supercalifragilisticexpialidocious. and turn that into a password. And that right there has about a century century hack time. It'll take the computer about 100 years to get through that password.
So that's good. Strong passwords, encryption, VPNs, Tor, and the simple thing like putting a bandage or a sticker over your camera. So let's say somebody's computer has been compromised, or they think it's been compromised. Now what should they do?
Okay, let's say your computer was compromised. A couple of different ways. Isolate that computer from your network. Take it offline if you wish. If you have network sharing, immediately disable that. Disconnect the network cable or remove it from your wireless network. That way it doesn't transmit to the other systems or doesn't transmit any additional information. I mean, that's the very first thing that you need to do. If you can, turn off that computer, take out the hard drive, put it in as a secondary drive in another system. That way you can run a scan on it and see if there's anything that was compromised, if there were any malicious files added in, if any malware got added. You can run programs such as Prep Cleaner and Malware Bytes. Those are some of the easiest ones to run for users. You can use it online.
You said Crap Cleaner and Malware Bytes?
Yes. Okay. Crap Cleaner and Malware Bytes. By the way, secret tool that Best Buy uses. Oops, did I just leak their secrets?
Did they charge you crazy amounts of money to run on your computer and erase all your data?
Yes. What I'm telling you right now with running a search on your computer for these will cost you $190 if you bring it to one of their locations. They run Crap Cleaner and Malware Bytes to look for a virus, and then they run Avast antivirus on the file. All three are freeware.
And they get paid $190 to run some freeware.
Yeah. So to save yourself a whole lot of money and a whole lot of grief, two of the main files that you need, Crap Cleaner, Malware Bytes.
Crap Cleaner, Malware Bytes.
And while your system, if you have everything set up, like if you have a second system, when you put that drive in as a secondary drive, run both of those on there and run your antivirus on it. If anything was dropped in, it will find it.
Just scan the hell out of it.
Oh, yeah. Have it do a deep scan.
All right.
Now, while you're also doing that, try to back once the scan goes through. And this is something that you should have been doing from the beginning. Back up. Back up your important data onto things like flash drives, things that you can keep off of your computer. That way you don't have to worry about them. And if none of the systems can clear out whatever's on your hard drive, format the sucker. Basically do a full hard drive, do a full drive format on it. Do it at least 3 to 4 times, just the format, so that way you completely wipe all the data as unreadable.
Yeah. Good plan. Well, let's take a quick break and listen to another song, and we'll be back in a minute with Se7en. And when we come back, we can maybe get into some OpSec, see how it differs and talk about that a little bit.
Watching me. Life. I work from 9 to 5. Hey, hell, I pay the price. All I want is to be left alone.
Okay, we're back with my non-objective opinion on People's Radio United. We're talking about internet security and OpSec with Se7en. I said we're going to get into OpSec right now, Se7en, but I totally skipped cell phones. Can we talk about security on cell phones real quick?
Not a problem. With cell phones, you're going to want to make sure that you either have a password, the lock screen password protected, or PIN code protected. Personally, not a fan of some of the newer phones that have fingerprint. It's basically a fingerprint lock, because as we're starting to learn right now, what's happening like with the iPhone fingerprint lock, there are people that are starting to print up 3D printed fingerprints.
Yeah.
So all you would have to do is a thin print, and they could put it on their finger and unlock your device. Now, granted, they're going to have to figure out which of your fingers you're actually using. Some people are tricky and use their toe. Things like the new, which one is that? The new Samsung?
With the retina?
Yeah, retinal scanning. Okay, retinal prints are far more unique than fingerprints. But at the same time, do you really want your retinal scan to be able to be accessed by anybody?
Yeah, you don't know who they share information with. I mean, it's crazy.
Yeah. I mean, I'd say encrypt your device. Make sure that you keep files that you want to keep private on the device itself, rather than on the memory card, because the memory card won't get encrypted. All the encryption is on your device itself.
You can do a separate encryption for memory cards on some phones.
On some phones, yeah. On most phones that you buy nowadays don't have that. You have to go through a specialty phone, something like the Black Phone, Black Phone 2, the BlackBerry Priv, which unfortunately looks like BlackBerry's going to be backing out of the cell phone market now because of that. It hasn't picked up the way that they hoped. Different types of things like the Nexus. The Nexus actually, you can encrypt your micro SD card. So that's a good thing. But then you have other phones like, let's say the iPhone. The iPhone, even though it does have its own encryption in it, and you have different types of locks. Okay, yes, it is good that you can secure it. But one of the bad things is that it is almost a nightmare to set up a VPN on it. To run Tor in some cases, especially on newer versions of the OS, you have to jailbreak it. It's the only way that you do it. It's, in some cases, the only way that you can install Tor.
That's just a hassle. Sure.
Yeah, it becomes too much of a pain sometimes to actually get the security on there by breaching the existing security, which then makes it weaker later on. Let's say somebody tries to access your device, a jailbroken device, unless you've set it up correctly, has a weaker security than a standard.
That's a messed up situation.
Yeah. With Android, though, it's kind of the reverse. Basically getting full admin rights on your device is amazing. Mm-hmm. You'd be able to set all the permissions for each of the different applications that are on there. You can remove geotagging from all of your pictures directly from the operating system itself. It'll prevent any type of geolocation from being added to pictures. You can have it set then for VPN to be active on boot, rather than having to activate it after the fact. You can add DNS changers, which will go along with the VPN, so that way it makes it even harder for somebody to trace exactly what device you're using.
What about Bluetooth?
Bluetooth, I'd say only if you're going to use a Bluetooth, only activate Bluetooth when you need to. The rest of the time, keep it turned off, because if you don't have a decent security set up on your device, somebody can actually do a Bluetooth hack and access your personal files using the Bluetooth connection. Some people don't have it where Bluetooth verification is enabled, where just anything can connect to it. Those are the people that I actually do feel really sorry for, because their data is compromised no matter what type of encryption you use.
Okay, that's pretty much it for cell phones, I think. Covered everything really quick. You want to talk about OpSec and how it differs and what's the difference between just basic internet security and OpSec for those who are involved in working with ops and other people and activists and things like that?
Sure. This will be something that covers a broad spectrum of things, including a lot of things that we've already talked about. OpSec, short for Operation Security, which is something that's good for people within the press, people within different organizations, basically reporters, hackers, activists, and yes, even some slacktivists. basically having operational security is a very good thing. Keeping your information in a secure, basically as people are researching information, only a few people are working on that research. They use secure forms of communication with each other, such as things like Telegram, basically going into different types of IRCs to be able to speak about things. Basically using as much data encryption as possible for the actual communications. That way you make sure that your data is secured, the information that we're researching is secured. And another big thing is you don't talk about it. If you're talking about things openly, it's information that the group, that everybody within that group that we're working with has agreed upon needs to be released. You set a time frame, you set a time, a day for the data to actually be released to the public, and try to keep everything as secure as possible beforehand. It goes to the World War II adage of loose lips sink ships. Mm-hmm. Same type of thing, except in a digital format. And in some cases, some things that you find in the digital world also have a real life effect. Some projects that you might be in, that you might be looking into, or that some people are getting interested in, could be something that governments are looking at and are trying to keep quiet. So keeping as much information secure as possible, even from them, is a really good idea.
Yeah, also protecting the other people involved in the op with you. That's important too.
Oh yes, I use a voice changer for my own health.
That's important. So yeah, anything else on OpSec?
That's the basics on it. A lot of it is learn as you go. Mm-hmm. A lot of people will actually help you out with trying to figure out different aspects of it as you're learning it.
Yeah.
Basically, the biggest thing about providing good OpSec is staying quiet whenever possible. If you have something that you're giddy about that you really want to jump on, information that you think will end up making a huge difference on something, speak to the others that you're working with, and only work within those that you trust within a small group.
Back to the loose lips. Trying to ships. That's like you said.
Exactly. Trying to compartmentalize a lot of the information and keep it secure, that's a couple of the biggest things when it comes to operational security.
Okay. So, yeah, I guess that's about it for everything. I mean, we covered everything pretty much, don't you think?
But there's one thing that we did talk about before the show.
Okay.
I'm just going to loosely touch on this.
Go ahead.
There have been quite a few people that are new out there. They're hearing a lot about the dark web. They want to go in. They want to have fun in there. Here's a little something that you should know. If you're thinking about going into there, don't do that. VPN up. Once you feel comfortable basically running on VPNs and Tor, okay, start learning about stacking VPNs. Learn about virtual machines. Because these are things that you're going to need before you even want to go in.
You want to be super duper secure, right?
Paranoid security is required for the dark web. And that's just it. That's because there are wonderful people in there that are constantly looking for people that are looking for random things that just want to arrest people. You want to make sure that you are complete, that you are secured and locked down before you do it. You don't want to get a new phone and go, ooh, I'm going to go here.
Yeah.
It's not going to happen. But yeah, I just wanted to make sure that I touched on that.
Okay. Yeah, that was, I forgot all about that. My mind's all over. Cool. So thanks for being on the show, Se7en. I think it was informative. I really appreciate you coming on to do this. And hopefully, we can get together and do a Op Stop Suicide and Ops Arena Shim in the upcoming month or two, maybe.
Well, that would be great.
Okay, let me just give some little. Yeah, the next show is going to be with Alex Salazar about police terrorism and racism within the department. And on the 25th and 26th, I'm going to be doing some live shows. With Nolan Hack at the Kevin Cooper rally and the Ezel Ford march. So those will be live, so check those out. And thanks for listening, everybody. Thank you again, Se7en. See you guys next time. Next time. Next time. Next time. Next time.